Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast, your weekly dose of knife news and information about knives and knife collecting. Here's your hosts, Jim Person and Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast. I'm Jim Person.
And I'm Bob DeMarco from thenifejunkie.com. Welcome to the podcast where we talk about all things knives from here to there, wall to
wall. And everywhere. And got a good show coming up today, Bob. I think we're going to be getting into knife making, which is going to be kind of an interesting topic from your personal experience.
Yes, sir. My intro to knife making as I've experienced it from a cheap man's perspective and from the perspective of someone who fears commitment. So we'll take a look at how to get started and who knows, might get bitten by the bug.
Right. Never know. I wouldn't even know where to start. So I'm looking forward to that. Of course, we have our couple of show segments that we always do. We have a Knife Life News segment coming up. And this week, a couple of interesting news tidbits we're going to cover. Also, we have a Ships in the Night segment that we're going to be talking about. Bob's going to take a look at the ZT Emerson 640. So new knife there to adventure into taking a look at.
A new Christmas knife, Jim. It's exciting because it feels like it was free.
Oh, well, it was.
I guess it was. Yeah. I guess you pay for everything in one way or another.
Right. Exactly. Pocket check. Folks know I've still got my buck canoe. I'm really loving it. I don't know if you're going to get it back, Bob, but we'll talk about that at some point.
Jim, I might not want it back after you've instilled it with your juju. You know, maybe
that's right. That's right. Point.
And if you get cut by it, I'm not taking it back. It's your knife if you cut yourself with it.
So. Well, I might have to accidentally cut myself then.
That's a superstition I have. If I cut myself with a knife, it's finally mine.
Okay.
I'm cutting myself all the time.
Well, have you cut yourself with any of the knives you have in your pocket today?
Not yet, but I'm expecting to in the near future. I have in my right pocket today, I have another new knife. I've gotten a number of them recently, and this is my second Wii knife. And you might think it looks a little interesting. This is the Wii Knives 609, and it's got a purple anodized handle.
I was going to say, I love the color.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. And the whole knife overall is kind of futuristic. It reminds me a little bit of the ZT0055 that I was carrying for a little while, a couple weeks back. And as a matter of fact, I'm going to be doing a video comparing them. But this is my second Wii knife. And I have to say, you know, they're the hot OEM company and they have a lot of their own models, such as this one. And they are as great as everyone says. I've been not resistant to get them, but they're just pricey enough that there are other knives in that price category that I've been going for over the past year. And man, taking a dive into Wii knives has been a harrowing experience because they have so many models. You know, they've only been around for about 4 years, 3.5 years, and they have such a huge product line. And now that I know that what everyone's saying is true, they just are like magnificently produced knives. I'm going to have to get a whole bunch.
Sounds like Wii knives will be a future topic for us in 2019.
Yeah. I think so.
All right. What else is in your pocket?
I got the Benchmade proper to keep me civilized in my left pocket in case I have to actually pull out a knife and cut something in front of someone. It's a nice knife. It's not my favorite slip joint, but I like its sort of modern interpretation of the slip joint. And then I have my broken skull, pink broken skull in the waistband. As per usual.
Yeah, that's one of the normals, although for the past couple of weeks, it kind of got taken out of your pocket for a while, but it's back, I see.
Well, yeah, you know, I'm just hanging around the house today, so I don't think I need the Black Talon for its ultimate ripping and penetration, you know, because I'm not going out today.
So three knives in Bob's pocket is normal. The buck canoe for me. We've got a great show coming up for you. Again, as we said, we're going to get into knife making, getting your feet wet without breaking the bank, and that's coming up.
You're listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. It's time now for the latest Knife Life News.
Okay, we're on Knife Life News and an interesting topic, Bob, that I wanted to start this segment with because last week we had a knife laws segment where we talked about, London, England. And interestingly, January 1st, there was a story that came out about three people being wounded in a Manchester knife attack. So I just thought that was tragic, obviously, but
Timely.
Yeah, that we had just talked about it in knife laws.
Though that being said, Jim, I know that that is one of the major violent crime types in England, knife crimes and those acid attacks, which is just so ghoulish and ghastly. But I think you well, okay, this is my opinion. You start restricting people's ability to own weapons, and they're going to funnel into the weapons that are allowed. Kitchen knives, hammers, battery acid, or whatever they're using. It's pretty nasty.
Interesting about this story, they actually had a witness who was a radio producer for BBC, which I thought that was kind of interesting that he happened to be there and witness it. I'm not sure if he reported on it or whatever, but yeah, maybe that's the reason it became more prominent in the media.
Straight from the street to the air.
Exactly. You've got an interesting story in the news this week about Buck.
Yeah, that's right. Buck Knives just announced that they're going to be starting to Cerakote blades in 2019. Now, it came as a shock to me that Buck Knives, that has a 132,000 square foot manufacturing facility in Idaho, didn't have Cerakote capabilities up until now. It's kind of funny, but they're going to start doing this in 2019. And it's, you know, the regular polymer ceramic composite coating that gets used on other knives and guns. It stops corrosion and chemicals, and it adds to strength and such. But to me, I found this interesting because Buck for a long time has been making a lot of outdoor knives, mostly out of stainless steels. They use a lot of 420, but maybe this Cerakote ability means that they're going to start making outdoor knives with knife steels better suited to outdoor and camp capabilities, or camp chores. Like high carbon steels and tool steels that are more susceptible to corrosion, but tougher and better for camp tasks. So maybe they're going to be shifting and improving their steel line. And maybe that's what this Cerakote capability is a harbinger of.
Oh, interesting. Okay. So maybe more to it than just an initial story, it seems like.
Yeah. Yeah. It also just seems odd to me that they haven't had this ability before, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
Hey, what do you know?
Especially for a name like Buck.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, also in the news this week, Boker, in a story from American Tool and Knife Institute on January 1st, Boker announced they were going to be celebrating 150 years by producing an exclusive series of commemorative knives. And the models that they selected for the anniversary series are what they're referring to as an important part of Boker history and represent an overview from the oldest of all of Boker's camp knife up to the more modern design like the Cub. So 150 years, you know, we sometimes don't think about knives, you know, being celebrated and in manufacture that long. But as our first tool indicates that we have on our show from time to time, knives are truly the first tool and date way back to ancient times.
Yeah, that's right. And you look at some of the knives that Boker's going to be putting out. One of them looks a little bit like a boy's knife, like a locking, folding boy's knife. And it just made me think, wow, you know, there are companies making those today that they've been made for a couple of hundred years now. And, you know, a knife is a knife is a knife. And then you look at this this Wee Knife 609 and you realize it's just window dressing. All of this coating and milling.
Right. One more thing I wanted to mention on Boker there, the tree logo is going to be in the handle, and that's a special anniversary edition that's going to be part of this 150-year celebration. Now, these knives are going to be available for purchase in the spring, and that's going to be through their site. And interestingly, they are made exclusively for the United States market. They're individually serial numbered and going to be strictly limited to 150 pieces each. So nice. Talk about some limited availability there, which also probably means a little higher price point.
Yeah, and it also means major collectability, Jim, and that's something you might want to keep your eye out on. So maybe you snatch a couple of these up, wait a few years, and then sell them off if you don't use them and carry them yourself.
Yeah, be interested in that. Knife Life News, anything else, Bob, you want to throw in before we wrap up this segment?
Yeah, I just wanted to mention, Jim, just a little teaser to something I'm going to be talking about over this week, and we'll talk about on the podcast next week, a little bit more about Wee Knives, because I've been getting my feet wet with Wee Knives and am so incredibly impressed with what I've seen in the knives that I have. They've just announced that they're coming out with a kitchen line, and I am very excited about that because I am not one of these guys who uses his pocket knife in the kitchen. I always thought that was weird. A lot of reviewers over the years talk about a pocket knife's ability as a or value as a kitchen knife. It's just weird to me. Use a kitchen knife. And now Wee Knife is coming out with kitchen knives. You got no excuse. So, yeah, I'm going to be talking about these high quality, beautifully made 67-layer Damascus kitchen knives that we's coming out with.
Well, and I have to agree with you, Bob. A kitchen knife is for use in the kitchen. You know, I would never think about cutting vegetables or doing any other kind of kitchen work with my pocket knife.
Yeah, maybe if you're camping or you're at work.
Yeah,
you
know,
I use mine at work all the time to cut stuff up. But I mean, you're at home in your kitchen, may as well have a little bit more than a 3.5-inch pocket knife.
Got a whole drawer full of kitchen knives. Might as well use them.
That's right.
Well, talking about knives, we're going to be getting into our main segment, talking about knife making, getting your feet wet without breaking the bank. But just a couple of reminders. Bob mentioned videos coming out this week. Just want to remind you to go to thenifejunkie.com/video, and you'll find all of the videos there that you want to see. Thenifejunkie.com/YouTube is also another great way to find it. Also, be sure to subscribe to the Knife Junkie newsletter. We just started our first issue at the new year, and we want to encourage you to join us there at thenifejunkie.com/subscribe. That'll get you right to the place to subscribe, and you'll be on the weekly newsletter to get knife news and more. So stay tuned for that right here on the Knife Junkie podcast.
And now that we're caught up with Knife Life News, let's hear more of the Knife Junkie podcast.
And we're back on the Knife Junkie podcast. Jim and Bob with you. Thanks again for listening to the Knife Junkie podcast. Be sure to visit the website at thenifejunkie.com. Take a tour around there, see what you can see, and also be sure to visit the calendar of knife shows and knife events. That's at thenifejunkie.com/calendar. We've added several items to the calendar this week, and it's upcoming knife shows and that, so be sure to find that. If you have a knife show or knife event or something you want to get on the calendar, go to thenifejunkie.com/submit. So again, that's thenifejunkie.com/calendar to see all the events. And to submit something for the calendar, thenifejunkie.com/submit.
Follow the Knife Junkie on Instagram at thenifejunkie.com/Instagram.
Okay, Bob, we've talked about knives and knife collecting, knife styles, knife grinds, all kind of introductory stuff on some of the earlier issues of the podcast. Today, though, kind of an interesting take for us. We're going to be talking actually about knife making. And you're into knife making, but we're going to kind of bring it from the standpoint of how to get started without breaking the bank, if you will.
Right, right. I mean, my compulsion towards knife making came from two different directions. One being a lifelong collector of knives and having kind of an insatiable appetite for always getting and having new knives. So the ability to make your own knives just kind of adds to your ability to acquire new ones. But also I went to years of art school and, you know, I work with my hands and such. And I always thought, knife making must be a very gratifying process.
Right.
At the end of it, you come out with something usable.
Well, and you talked about that art background. You've started something interesting, actually, the beginning of this year. You're committed to do a knife design drawing every day.
Every single day. So this is an idea I got from Lucas Burnley, who, if you don't know him and you like knives, you've been under a rock because he is a very prolific designer. He has a lot of his, designs made by, well, Boker makes his like most famous knife, the Quaken. And then CRKT makes a bunch of, his knives. One of their top selling knives is his knife, the Squid. And, I follow him on Instagram. So I know that he lives up in Cape Cod and he makes his own custom knives, as well as making designs that are mass manufactured. And last year on Instagram, he set forth a challenge to himself. I think he called it the 365 challenge, where he was drawing 365 sheets worth of knives. And when I say sheets worth, I just mean a piece of paper filled up with drawings of knives. And he was labeling them day number 4, you know, and then the date. And he did that for 365 times. Now, it seemed like it lasted for longer than a year, but that's neither here nor there. I just really, really respected the discipline of doing that creative act every single day. And I watched over that 365 day period how many unexpected and strange designs started to come out amongst his very normal designs. And then I also noticed how a number of the designs from that 365 drawing challenge ended up in production with CRKT. So it's that consistency idea. That's my New Year's resolution, Jim, is to be a more consistent person. It's always been something I've struggled with, you know, it's a challenge. And to have a knife maker like Lucas Burnley be a role model in that aspect of my own self-improvement has been a good thing to look to.
And you're going to be sharing some of those on Instagram, I understand.
I will indeed. But I will give credit where credit's due, and I will tag Lucas Burnley and thank him for the idea. But I'm also hoping not just to become a more consistent person, but to break out of my own design echo chamber. When I draw things, I tend to draw with the motion of my hand, with the curves that my wrist will give me. I end up drawing some of the same things over and over. And right. I think forcing myself every day to do 3 or 4 new knives is going to, it's just going to yield some unexpected designs for me that I can later try and make.
Absolutely. My son's an artist and he loves drawing, superheroes and characters and anime. And we keep trying to tell him, do something different because you need the experience of trying to draw something different, because anytime he sits down to draw it, again, it's the same thing that comes out. So go ahead, Bob, stretch your imagination, come up with something new. And again, that's thenifejunkie.com/Instagram. You can follow Bob, the Knife Junkie, on Instagram there. Let's get into knife making, Bob. Let's talk about it.
So I have to preface this all by saying I'm speaking strictly of stock removal knife making, not forging a knife. That's a talent I will cultivate a little later in life when we move a little further away from the city and I have more space and I can start a forge. And what I'm talking about is stock removal knife making. You're starting with a bar of steel, and with the use of different tools and processes, you're removing the steel that's not a knife. Basically, it's like sculpture, walking up to a piece of marble and chipping away until you have David. That's what stock removal knife making is.
Okay. Okay.
So this kind of knife making, you can start from what you have in your garage right now. All you really need to do is acquire the materials. Get yourself some good blade steel. I like to use New Jersey Steel Baron, but a lot of places like Jan's and USA Knife Maker, they sell steel also. I would recommend you start with a 1095 or an easy to work with high carbon steel, and then get a couple of pins and some handle material. That could be wood or a couple of cheap little slabs of G10 that you can get at an online knife materials seller, and you can get started. You need a drill and files. That's it. I mean, that's how I started. And then I slowly got sick of the workout and started to acquire tools.
Okay.
But really, a round file and a bastard file is a great way to start.
So you've got this slab of steel, and you're filing it down, you're cutting it down. I mean, that sounds like a lot of work.
Okay, it is a lot of work. All right, so instead of using a hacksaw and cutting it out, which is what I did with my first knife, I cut out the contour. I drew the design on a small piece of steel. I cut out the jagged contour with a hacksaw, and then I started filing to smooth out and shape. That took forever. I created a little jig that I could clamp the knife into, and file and get a consistent angle. But Jim, it took forever. So then I went and I bought an angle grinder. An angle grinder, something you could just get at Home Depot, and it has cutoff wheels and it has sanding wheels. This can radically speed up the process. So get your piece of steel. It's a rectangle. You're going to draw your knife on it.
Okay.
You're going to clamp that piece of steel in a vise. You're going to take your angle grinder with a cutoff wheel, and you're going to cut the shape out. And then from there, you're going to use the angle grinder sanding wheel and eventually have a beautifully contoured knife.
Okay. So again, this is for beginners without having to spend a lot of money, without breaking the bank as we're talking about it. Is this, I'm assuming, how everybody kind of gets started? Is this kind of the first steps that you need to get there? Or are there different ways that people can
actually get started? There are different ways. Now, okay. I looked at this book called The $50 Knife Shop, and it's kind of a classic knife maker's book by Wayne Goddard. And it had a lot of different suggestions, and I looked at a lot of different YouTube videos. But really what it comes down to is if you can get your hands on an angle grinder, some sandpaper, a Dremel, or a drill, you can start.
So those are the key tools that you need.
Yeah. And then you're going to want a belt sander so that you don't have to file in the, to use a file and create a jig to put on your bevels. And then you're off.
So part of this podcast episode is kind of knife making for the beginner, but also without breaking the bank. We're kind of talking about getting your feet wet without breaking the bank. What are we at money-wise already when we're talking about, you know, sheets of steel or, you know, some of the basic tools like files and those kind of things are not very expensive. But then we start getting into the sanders and grinders. I'm imagining a little bit more money. So kind of break down that cost for us a little bit.
Okay. Well, you're going to, like I said, you're going to want some files. You're going to want a set of small files so you can create jigging or jimping or choils. You're going to want a big file and a small round file. So that'll take you up to about $35. Get an angle grinder for $50, bunch of sandpaper of different grits. So we're talking about $125, Jim. You can have an angle grinder. You can have sandpaper. You can have files and you can buy a piece of steel and some pins for about $125, $150.
Oh, okay.
And you can get started with that.
Okay. So where is piece of steel? Do you get that at any hardware store? I mean, does it have to be special ordered?
Well, the steel you get at a hardware store is not going to be hardenable steel. You're going to want to go to a place online like the New Jersey Steel Baron or Jantz or USA Knife Maker. They all sell steel and they sell it in different thicknesses and widths. So, you know, say you're going to make a big chef's knife, a big wide bladed chef's knife. You would get a 2.5-inch wide piece of steel, but you would get it thin. So all these different options are offered to you at these blade steel places, you know, New Jersey Steel Baron, chief among them.
How did you decide which knife to start with? How did you know what length of steel, what width of steel, what type of steel, what type of knife even that you wanted to do? Was it just something that kind of as you're drawing or whatever, you had this design, you thought, you know, it might be kind of cool for me to have this knife. And so that drove what you needed and that kind of led to the knife making process?
Yes. Yeah. I always wanted a Bowie knife, a great American Bowie knife that was small enough to stash on my person. And so I started with the high carbon 1095 steel because I had read that it is easy to work with, especially for a newbie such as myself. And then I knew that I wanted micarta handles. Micarta is a material. It's a very resistant to the elements and shock resistant and grippy material that's created by compressing canvas or linen or any other sort of material at high pressures with epoxy. And it looks kind of like G10 and it also looks kind of like a natural material. And I knew I wanted that because of its gripping capabilities. Even when it's wet, it feels grippy. And so I got two small plates of that, which you can buy for, you know, less than $5. So basically the design I knew I wanted to carry dictated the materials I bought for it. But I made a big mistake on my first knife. So after you create the knife, after you get the blank created and you have your edge bevels on, that's the part of the blade that angles in towards the edge. Then you send it off to get heat treated because I don't have a heat treat oven and I don't have any way to accurately heat treat a knife at my place. So I sent it to True Grit, which is an abrasives retailer and also knife making stuff out in the West Coast. They also have a heat treat service there. It takes a little while. It comes back. And then I realized, ooh, I should have drilled the holes to hold the pins for the handle material before I had it hardened. Because before you have the steel hardened, it's relatively soft and easy to work with. And that's the time to drill all of your holes and to get all of your major milling and stuff in. Mm. And when it's hardened, you want to do a lot more of the finishing work, not so much of the shaping and cutting work.
Right.
And so I had a hell of a time drilling out the holes to put the pins through to hold the handles because gotcha. All I had was a hand drill. And, you know, even with the awesome drill press I have now, yeah, it would still be much more difficult to cut through a hardened steel blade.
Right. Lesson learned. I'm sure you only made that mistake once.
Yeah, exactly. Now, if it sounds like I don't know what I'm talking about, Jim, it's because I partially don't. You know, this is a process I'm learning as I go. I'm hacking through it. I'm using YouTube channels. I'm using experience. I'm using books and I'm using my wit to try and get through this. The wit hasn't helped much at all.
Well, that was going to be a question I was going to ask you. How how does one actually learn to make knives? I mean, I'm sure there are knife making classes or schools or institutes that you can go to, but to do it on your own, to learn at your house, to do it on your own, I think you mentioned books, YouTube channels, videos, those type of things are great learning resources.
Yes, no doubt. I mean, I think, Jim, the ultimate way to learn is to apprentice with someone. That's kind of a fantasy of mine, but I'm not at the age where I can just dip out of my life and apprentice under a knife maker. But right. Who knows? I'm young at heart, and when I retire someday, maybe I will do that. So the ultimate way to learn how to make knives is to apprentice under someone who already knows how. Then I would say outside of that is just being consistent, showing up. You know, 90% of life is showing up. So just keep working on them and making them.
And how many would you say you've made so far in your short career of knife making?
I've made about 20. A few of them have been uncharacteristically awesome. Like I was just hit with blind luck every time I was at whatever machine I was at, and it came out nicely. So now at this point, I use a 2x42-inch belt sander. It's a Craftsman. It does not have a variable speed motor. It doesn't have an accurate platen, which is the part behind the sanding belt. And I figure if I can get good at making knives on this very basic machine, that gives me very little control. When I finally graduate to a nice 2x72-inch knife maker's grinder, which is the main tool, then I'll be good, because I've been forged in the crucible of crapulence, and I will graduate to something nice.
Right.
Another very essential tool, once you can afford it, or once you're willing to drop a little more cash into it, is get a drill press. Drill press makes your life much easier. You need epoxy, you need pins, you need various things. You'll find that out as you go, and you'll find that out when you get these books or look at these knife making videos. Maybe I'll do a starting video. But the thing I want to run down are the tools that I now find totally valuable. When I started off, I said, oh yeah, all you need is a file and some sandpaper and you can make knives. Yeah, you can if you're on a desert island and you have all that time.
Right, if you got a year or two to make one.
Right, exactly. So my very basic tool set, because I'm very cautious about spending a lot of money on tools because I know how much time I have to spend on it. And in the past, I've jumped into things, spent a lot of money, and then in the end, that money was wasted because I didn't fully immerse myself in the activity. I'm always kind of worried I'm going to do that again, so I take it easy now. And my very basic tool set now includes an angle grinder, files, this 2x42-inch belt sander, a Dremel, mine is a flex shaft, and a drill press. And with all of those things, and then using a heat treat service out of house, I can get a knife made. And then, you know, I've done bits about kydex and how to make kydex. For sheaths, that's a whole nother thing. You learn how to make leather, you learn how to make kydex. But with those basic tools, I am able to make a knife that is tough enough to do outdoor work, is pretty enough to give to a lady, or just handy enough to wear around your neck all day long. And to me, that's a good start. I'm going to get better. I'm going to know my stuff more. And all of that will help get better equipment. But for now, that's what I can do. Now, right. My gift to myself this year for Christmas is going to be an even treat heat treating oven. I'm sorry. Did I say even treat? I meant even heat. That's the name of the brand. And it's a big kiln that, you can heat treat your own knives in. So I don't have to send them out in the middle of my process to, a manufacturer, to someone else to heat treat. And it will speed up my knife production. So quite possibly next time we speak, I will have heat treated my own knife.
Well, that will save you a lot of time and some money.
A little bit of money, but definitely a lot of time, because I'm small potatoes. I send my stuff out to get heat treated. And, you know, there's some show coming up somewhere, some knife show. So a maker that has more clout or more experience is ahead of me in the queue. And it takes a while for me to get my stuff. So, yeah, right. I'm going to cut out the middleman and I'm going to start heat treating my own knives.
Awesome. Okay. Well, I think it'd be great to actually hear from folks that are making their knives, regardless of your level of expertise or your stage in knife making. We'd love to hear from you. What tools did you start with? What are you doing? How many knives are you making? Give us a call on the Knife Junkie listener line and let us know. That number is 724-466-4487. Again, that's the listener line, 724-466-4487. Just leave a message on there. Let us know, again, kind of how you got started, what kind of tools you use, how much money you started with to get into knife making, kind of where you're at in the stage. And also, if you'd like to share with our audience about your experience and would like to be a guest on the KnifeJunkie.com podcast, go to the KnifeJunkie.com/guest. You can be a guest on the Knife Junkie podcast. There's a little form to fill out and get some information, and we can try to schedule you to talk about your experiences with knife making. Bob, final thoughts as we kind of wrap up this segment about getting your feet wet with knife making without breaking the bank?
Yeah, well, you know, as I sit here and I talk and I think about what I've said, it might be apparent to the seasoned knife maker that I'm a newbie. And I think it's always a great spot to be. It's always good to be new at something, especially in a difficult pursuit. I want to make beautiful knives someday. I've made a few beautiful knives so far, but I mean, I want to someday be great at it. And I have nothing but improvement. I have nowhere to go but up. And as I go and as I make more knives and I take more notes and I remember the bad things I did on the last knife and improve that going forward, this is a pursuit that gives you very, very tangible record of how well you're doing. And I'm just excited to see what happens over the next year. I think on this day next year, my knives are going to be awesome. Right now, okay. I think they're awesome.
Right.
So you know what I'm saying? They're just going to keep getting better.
You think they're awesome, but this time next year, everybody else will think they're awesome.
Yes. And my friends and family tell me they're awesome. So it's got to be true.
That's got to be true. All right.
Support the Knife Junkie podcast by shopping on Amazon. Just visit amazon.thenifejunkie.com.
Some good intro to knife making without breaking the bank. Again, if you're a knife maker, we'd love to hear from you. Call the listener line at 724-466-4487 with some tips or tricks or whatever. And again, if you'd like to be on the podcast to tell us all about your experience, go to thenifejunkie.com/guest and we can try to schedule you to be on the podcast. You're listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast, brought to you by thenifejunkie.com.
You're listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast, and now with our Ships in the Night segment is the Knife Junkie.
All right, Jim, I just wanted to show this off to you. I got a new knife, yes, yet again, and this is the new ZT0640. It's a collaboration with my favorite designer, Ernest Emerson, and it was a surprise to the market, to the knife community. They just sort of popped out with it at the end of last year, pretty much unannounced. And it is awesome. It is a large EDC, I'd say. It has a 3.75 inch 20 CV clip point blade. It's very sleek and it has a very neutral feel to it. And what I mean by this is Emerson's usually have the wave on top and they usually have finger choils and forceful ergonomics. And by that, I mean, it forces your hand into a certain grip. This knife, the 640, is a much sleeker, much more Sabenza-like look. It's got a neutral handle that you can use in any grip, and it does not have the wave obstructing your thumb or automatically deploying the knife as you pull it out. So it's a little different than a usual Emerson. It's based on an older design by Ernest Emerson called the Viper. And I think even the name Viper alludes to the fact that it's sleek and, you know, you can push this into any number of uses. I've already used it in some EDC tasks, cutting zip ties. It excelled at, but I mean, shouldn't it? It's a pocket knife. Another thing that's been talked about a lot, aside from this not having a wave, is this sort of puke green carbon fiber that they have on the handle. No, you know what? I'll call it split pea soup green. That sounds a lot nicer. Split pea soup green carbon fiber. A lot of people don't like it. I think it's really cool. When was the last time you saw green carbon fiber? So this knife is really adding up to be a classic. I think I'm going to put it in my collection next to my Sabenza and next to the Benchmade Crooked River because they're thumb stud deployed, classic, clean lined clip point blades. And I think ZT just hit an absolute home run with this. My one beef with it is the pocket clip, which comes straight off of the 920, which I didn't like on the 920 either. It doesn't give you much room and it doesn't ride very low. But I've already remedied that by ordering a clip. And once that comes, I think this knife is going to be very hard to kick out of my pocket.
How'd you like that upgrade on Ships in the Night? Now here's more of the Knife Junkie Podcast.
All right, that's going to do it, unfortunately, for the time we have on episode number 11 of the Knife Junkie Podcast. Good show today as we kind of dived into beginning knife making with Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco as he's getting his feet wet with knife making without breaking the bank. Love to hear from you about your thoughts on that. Also covered in the show today, we had the Knife Life News, where we covered some new activity going on in the world of knives, some knife news with Buck and Boker Knives. And we also just had our Ships in the Night segment covering the ZT Emerson 0640 that Bob gave a quick little knife review on.
You're listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. Call the Knife Junkie at 724-466-4487 with your questions or comments.
Episode number 11 of the Knife Junkie Podcast. Thanks for listening. If you have any feedback, we'd love for you to go to reviewthepodcast.com and leave us a comment, a thought, a rating, or review. Again, that's reviewthepodcast.com. Again, if you're a knife maker just getting started into knife making, have any thoughts, disagree with anything Bob said, agree with some of his thoughts, have suggestions about tools, tips, tricks, or whatever, call the listener line at 724-466-4487 and let us know. You can actually leave a recording there that we can play back on the podcast in an upcoming episode to share your tips and tricks. And if you have a website, please feel free to go ahead and plug that. We'd love to give you some publicity as well. For Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco, I'm Jim the Knife Newbie Person. Thanks for listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast.
Thanks for listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please rate and review at reviewthepodcast.com. For show notes for today's episode, additional resources, and to listen to past episodes, visit our website, theknifejunkie.com. You can also watch our latest videos on YouTube at theknifejunkie.com/YouTube. Check out some great knife photos on theknifejunkie.com/Instagram and join our Facebook group at theknifejunkie.com/Facebook. And if you have a question or comment, email them to Bob at theknifejunkie.com or call our 24/7 listener line at 724-466-4487. And you may hear your comment or question answered on an upcoming episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast.